So we will be discussing today O Ohm's law. So the question arises, is V is equal to IR O Ohm's law? You know, you are familiar with this equation, V is equal to IR, I know, and you may call it that it is in O Ohm's law. But my answer to this question is no, it is not O Ohm's law. Shocked, perhaps, most likely, you will be shocked that how V is equal to IR is not in Ohm's law. So let's discuss it in detail. So to explain it, for example, this is a conductor, any conductor. If you want to see how much is the resistance inside the conductors, so one way is to apply the potential difference across this conductor. So if one side, the left side of this conductor, is connected to the positive terminal and right side is connected to the negative terminal of the battery, and so we will say that the left side is at higher potential and the right side is at lower potential, and in this shows the flow of current. So the current flows from right to left. So we say that the polarity is positive, but if you reverse it, it means if this is connected to the negative terminal and the right one is connected to the positive terminal, then we say that the polarity is reversed. So when you apply this potential difference across this conductor and there is a flow of current, and then you vary this potential difference and the current also changes. Of course, it will be changing. But what about the resistance? Now, there are two possibilities. Resistance may change or it may not change. So, graphically, we can represent these two cases as this one. This is the first case. Here you see, from below 0, minus 2, minus 4, this is a negative polarity. And above 0, it is a positive polarity. Then you see that across x-axis, this is a potential difference, which is increasing from left to right. And along y-axis, here you see it is the current, which also increases while going from bottom to top. So you see this line, which shows basically the resistance. This shows that when you increase the potential difference, the current increases. The slope, which is basically V over I, this is resistance. So you see the resistance doesn't change. Resistance remains constant. In other words, we can say that resistance is independent of the potential difference. So, and the current, which is increasing linearly with increasing potential difference, by that current we measure the resistance of that conductor, which turns out to be 1000 ohm. So this is the one case. Another case, you see it is a p-n junction diode. For reverse polarity, for negative polarity, you see with increasing the potential difference, there is no current. The current is zero. And even for the positive polarity, when the potential difference increases, you see that the current increases but not linearly. So this graph is not linear. So again, this is governed by these equations. This whole phenomena, increasing in current with potential difference, this is governed by this equation, V is equal to IR. And previous plot was also governed by V is equal to IR. So V is equal to IR holds true in both cases, but the only difference is that in one case, R was independent of the potential difference, while in this case R is depending upon the potential difference. Here you see. So what does it mean? Can we say that in both cases V is equal to I R represent Ohm law? No, it is not the case. We say that Ohm law is an assertion that the current through a device is always directly proportional to the potential difference applied to the device. In the first plot, where there was resistance which was independent of the potential difference, and the current through their device was directly proportional to the potential difference applied to the device. Similarly, we can also say that a conducting device obeys Ohm's law when the resistance of the device is independent of the magnitude and polarity of the applied potential difference. We just change the words. Here we say that resistance of the device is independent of magnitude and polarity, and say that a conducting material obeys Ohm's law when the resistivity of the material is independent of the magnitude and direction of the applied electric field. This third case we will study it in detail. So a microscopic view, you know that the motion of conduction electron, that is governed by the laws of quantum mechanics. For example, the electrons are moving from point A to the point B, and these gray dashed lines show that there is no electric field. The potential difference is not applied yet. So when they will be moving from point A to the point B, so they don't move directly from point A to the point B, or rather they move randomly, okay? And if we just assume that they don't collide with each other and they just collide with the atoms present in that conductors, then by making collisions with these atoms, for example, one collision occurs here, another collision occurs here, and so on. And by making six collisions, an electron goes from point A to the point B. Now, when the electric field is applied in the direction which is shown here, from right to left in the directions, what will happen? So we know that electric field exerts an electric force on the electrons opposite to its directions. So if electric field is in this direction, electrons will be exerted, and the force will be exerted on the electron in the right directions. So we can say that these electrons, the path of these electrons, you see the green dashed lines, that they will be drifted towards right. Okay, so but keep in mind the drift speed in a typical metallic conductor is about 5 into 10 raised to the power minus 7 meter per second, which is very, very less than the effective speed of the electron, which is 1.6 into 10 raised to the power 6 meter per second. So this 1.6 into 10 raised to the power 6 meter per second is the speed of electrons when they are moving randomly. And this is the speed of electrons when electric field is applied on these electrons and they are drifted towards right. So we assume that drift speed is 0.02 of the 0.02 times of the effective speed. But keep in mind that the actual value is more like Vd is 10 raised to the power minus 13 times of effective speed, which is of course very less. So here the separation between the paths, you see it is very, very exaggerated. Now, if an electron mass, if an electron of mass m is placed in an electric field of magnitude E, okay, the electron will experience an acceleration given by Newton's second law. We know the equation, A is equal to F over m, where F is the electric force, m is the mass of electron, and A is the acceleration of electrons. So we can replace F with E, where E is the electric field, small e is the charge on electron, and m is the mass of electron. Now, in the average time, which is denoted by this T, between collisions, the average electron will acquire a drift speed of Vd is equal to At. So, we can write Vd is equal to At. If we put the values of A from here, which is small e capital E over m, and just we substitute this value here, so it will become E capital At over m. But we also know that J is equal to N E V D. J is the current density, N is the number of electrons per volume, E is the charge on electron, and V D is the drift speed. In magnitude form, we can write this equations, V D is equal to J over N E. Just rearrange it. So now look at these two equations. Equation number one is also for the Vd, for the drift speed, and equation number two is also for the drift speed. So if you just compare these two, so the right hand sides of these two equations will become equal. So J over Ne is equal to EET over M. You can write for electric field, just rearranging these equations, it will become E is equal to M over E square Nt over J. We also know that E is equal to rho J. From the previous lectures, we know that. Now, equation number 3 and 4 imply, if you look equation number 3 and equation number 4, both are equal because left hand sides of both equations are same. So, the right hand sides of both equations will also be same. So, you can calculate rho is equal to m over e square in t. So, this equation we derived. Rho, which is resistivity, m mass of electron, E is charge on electron, N is the number of conduction electrons per volume, and T is the average time of average time between two collisions. So we derive this equation, which is rho is equal to m over e square nt. So in this equation, these three terms, mass of electron, charge of electron, and n is the number of conduction electron per volume, they are constants. So if we are able to show that t, which is the average time, if it is constant, then we can conclude the rho, which is resistivity, that is also constant. If resistivity is constant, then we say that such material obeys Ohm law, or it is an ohmic material. If resistivity is not constant, then we can conclude that that material obeys Ohm law. Now look at this T. We can say that T can be considered constant. Why? Because we know that the drift speed, which was caused by the electric field, it is very, very smaller than the effective speed, that the electron speed, and thus T is hardly affected by the field. So T, which is basically the average time between two collisions, it is not affected by the electric field. So it means we can say, if all these terms are constant, if they are not changing, we can conclude that resistivity, it is constant. It is independent of the electric field. If resistivity is independent of the electric field, then those materials they obey Ohm's law. Hope it is clear. Thank you very much.